This is a video of a doctor getting beaten up in India. The patient's relatives are beating him up because they think that this doctor did not provide satisfactory care for the patient. Next year, I will be graduating as a doctor. And I know that when I graduate, I could not possibly provide the best care that is possible for the patient. That's because the amount of medical knowledge will double every 23 days by 2020. That's next year. And I know that I cannot keep up with so much information. In fact, all these books would already be outdated, and the book that I have in my hand reading would be outdated when I finish it. Not only that, the amount of information that we are generating, the amount of health information that we are generating, is exploding at an exponential rate. Take for example CT scans, MRIs, and just genomic data. Right now we are able to sequence complete genomes at a really cheap rate. So that will be more and more common in the future. And humans cannot just sit and analyze this and come up with the best decision to make. The matter would be made worse by smartwatches and smartphones collecting more and more information about us that hospitals don't even have access to. So I started learning about data science, machine learning, about 5 years ago. Most of it I learned online. And my real first contact with medical data was when I participated in a contest by Kaggle to detect diabetic retinopathy using images. So we trained a convolutional neural network to identify whether or not an image has diabetic retinopathy, and it did fairly well. But I was already in med school at this time. I was studying second year medicine, and we wanted to do more. We wanted to find out how the neural network was trying to identify what is in the images. So we ran a certain algorithm that would tell us, that would bring out the features of diabetic retinopathy in normal images. And with that, we were actually sweetly surprised to find out that the neural network had actually learned the same features that we as humans use to identify diabetic retinopathy. And we published a paper on the same. And that's when I realized that AI is not just a nice to have in the field of medicine. It is a necessity, because without it, we are just going to have all this data that we are never going to be able to analyze. So next I got started with, I wanted to try and use this new skills that I obtained by learning online to real healthcare data at my hospital. So that's when I approached the hospital and asked them, hey, can I have some data? Can I have some healthcare data? And they told me to fill in 101 forms in order to get that data. So it wasn't easy. It was really hard. And I ended up getting data through a shortcut. And that is because I was a medical student. I had access to the computers. So I could just type in any name, any hospital number, and I would get their medical information. But then I realized that they only had images of discharge summaries. That's it. And for example, comparing this discharge summary with that of HL7 Fire, which is the standard that is being told to hospitals worldwide by the HL7 community, it's not being followed at our own hospital. And the second thing is, I got this without the consent of the patient. In fact, this is my own discharge summary. So I think I don't need to give my own consent to get my own data. But I got this without my own consent, without me knowing it. So nobody from the hospital really informed me that this data was being accessed. And that brings us to the second problem. The first problem being data in the healthcare setting is not at all uniform. This is an image of a discharge summary, and that is a HL7 resource as it should be. The second is, Data without consent is a time bomb. And we've seen this time and time again with Google, Facebook getting one lawsuit after the other for not following safe practices in when it comes to dealing with data. So this is clear. I'm pretty sure it must be clear. Now, the third problem is anonymizing data before giving it to a data analyst does not ensure privacy. In fact, anonymization is a really weak guarantee of privacy. So, for example, there was a case of the governor of Massachusetts in which he suffered from something like a blackout. He fell on stage one day and that was covered in the media widely. Like, he was trying to give a talk and he fell down. So, there was also another data set that was released by a hospital and it was made public to everyone for everyone to analyze. Some really smart college student figured out that there was one data point in the data set in which somebody had fainted on the same exact day that the governor of Massachusetts had fainted, and that was public knowledge. So using that, she figured out that that data point belonged to the governor of Massachusetts. So this seems like it's not that big of a deal, but what if the governor had a health issue that he would not want revealed? Like, for example, if he had something like HIV or, you know, Ebola that he wouldn't want other people knowing, that was now completely broken just by the use of this other information that he had fainted on that particular day. So another instance was Netflix released the database of thousands of people, and they wanted data scientists to run algorithms to make better predictions. So what happened was people, these are college professors, I believe, they linked the data that Netflix gave them with the database that is already present on IMDb, and they saw who rated which movies. Although this database that was given by Netflix was completely anonymized, they started, they could find out who this person exactly was just by using the IMDb's public database. So these are the problems that are associated with just anonymizing data. So anonymization is a weak guarantee of privacy, and it's not enough, especially for something as sensitive as medical data. Now, the next problem is that they use something called K-anonymity in the medical space nowadays. So what this means is that K number of people, if given a data set, at least K number of people will have the same attributes. So you cannot identify one person based on that one single row in the database. It's a fairly mathematical concept. But what this means is that it would say, let's say a hospital is releasing a data set, Adam. So it would say that either Adam has either diabetes or high blood pressure. And the problem with this is that if another hospital decides to release another K anonymous data set in which it says Adam has either diabetes or emphysema, now we know exactly what Adam has, that he has diabetes, because these two hospitals don't talk to each other. So we have all these issues with privacy, and that is super important for medical data. Now, the next problem is AI as a model, using AI as a software as a service model in the cloud in itself is flawed. And the reason for that is, suppose you have your data and Google, for example, has an AI algorithm that is able to detect breast cancer, let's say. So now the problem with this is, in order for Google to do this prediction, you have to send this data to Google. So now, first of all, this is sensitive data by nature. You wouldn't want to just send this over to Google. And secondly, when Google has an algorithm that can predict with something like 99% accuracy, not only is your data leaked, but the diagnosis that you have or you do not have breast cancer is also leaked. So that is a big no-no. We don't want data going to Google. They already know enough about us. So can Google give their algorithm to you, to the hospital, in order for you to do the prediction locally? This seems like a better solution in which your data is not leaked. But the problem is, Google runs their whole business model based on the fact that they have this algorithm, and releasing that to a hospital would be a big no-no for them. So that is not happening. Google will have their algorithm to themselves. Now, these are all the problems that I've listed out: the data uniformity problem, the consent and transfer problem, the privacy preserving analysis problem, the private predictions problem, and the last problem is, why would anybody do any of the above to begin with? And we have solutions for each of them, and I will be talking more about that in the next video.